Thank you for coming. It's such an honor to be up here with teachers and women like Lu Chen and Naomi and Lorna, whose work made it possible for me to be here and for all of us to be here. So I want to offer a blessing first for us. Creator, thank you for this day and for this space to share our words and share in each other's company. We know this is not the first or last time that our writing will be censored, that our communities will be scapegoated and punished, and we ask you, Creator, to keep us safe and protected from inner and outer harm for all of us in this room and for all of our relations. To those who intend to hurt us with rifles, book bans, deny us our dignity, I ask that you bless them with health, love, and compassion so that they may see that there is enough good in the world for all of us, so that they may see themselves as holders of peace and not fear, Creator. I ask that you bless every one of my brothers and sisters in this room and with our communities who are suffering in Arizona and every one of the countries and neighborhoods we come from. May we treat each other with kindness and respect. May our inner cholas and cholos only be activated when we are at war and not because we are cranky. May this afternoon be filled with new ways to look at our world and grow from old patterns of suffering. May we ask this for all of our relations, big and small. So I think Sarah and I came up with a really good policy change for Arizona to make things different. We're going to take the air conditioning and all of the water. And I think that will pretty much take care of any pendejos that are left in Arizona. The rest of us know what to do when all those things are gone. So fuck that. Anyway. So as much as I want to, you know, talk about compassion and wish compassion for people who are hateful and filled with hate, I also have a couple of fuck you poems. So. This is for the fat ex-boyfriend. On the occasion that the fat, soon-to-be ex-boyfriend took yet another French fry, don't flutter your buttery boy lashes like you don't know what you did. Taking my French fries without asking, your sausagey stubby fingers, stealing my steak fries, curly fries, future fries, without asking me, without looking at me. I bought these fries with my Contempo casual sales girl pennies in a jar. Nah, fucker, I know you've got $3, buy your own damn fries. I am 2 apples high and have 3 more inches to grow. You are a full-grown aguacate tree, heavy with dark green huevos. Every time a turkey and cilantro sandwich comes out of my backpack, you eat half of it, dog. Half. Doesn't your job at the mini-mall Mexican jewelry pay you? Trying dull rubies and nugget gold on calloused fingers, you act like you got nothing in them new purple Lakers puffy jacket pockets. Your summer job money, oops, I forgot your birthday, but still ate the cake jacket. I see you looking at that bottle, redhead Chicana, in class, with more money than both of our families combined. Your lashes batting over her toes like they were hot from the fryer of Tommy's chili cheese fries. Nah, motherfucker, this is your last supper. I'm gonna stab you in the hand like Judas, take back any food you're gonna wanna eat, dig the tunnel with my hands right into that vieja's nappy sack, para que te deje como perro con pulgas later, and tell you right now, you're finished. And the rest of these fries are all fucking mine. Sometimes we do that shit to each other, right? You don't have to wait for Arizona to be whack. Long list of pendejos. This is from a book I'm working on. From the perspective, it's like a creative nonfiction book, and you all remember Prop 187, that old tune. It's great. That's how I kind of got started on this road, and so this is what that's from. When you're 17, all you want to do is get out of your dad's way. He's so fast with the chiflidos and the nose. No, he doesn't want to give you a ride to work at the mall. No, he doesn't think you should be holding a girl's hand. No, you should go to a college that's closer. No, so fast, he no longer nods. You already know that fool is against whatever it is you want. When you're 17, all you want to do is get out of your house, that house with too many beds and one room, a labyrinth you can see over, but you get stuck between the cushions trying to get out. That room with dead padrinos, unsmiling grandma, crusty angels protecting white hapless children watching over your sleep. Your old toys above the closet plotting their escape. Barbies in each other's clothing, mismatched heels, stuffed animals crusting with age and the memories of friends who gave them to you and moved away. A room crowded by two parents who hate each other in twilight and dusk, two little brothers who stay out of the way, but whose chanclas, white socks, and tight sweatshirts tumble out of a green metal dresser packed as a mule. When you're 17, maybe some of those friends who gave you monitos are still around. Maybe they like you, maybe they don't. Maybe they already punched you in the face. Maybe they're planning on it, but you can't tell which, and when they change their minds about being cool with you. This will haunt you until you're too old to care. You do not have the kind of heart that can sense subtle shifts in how people feel about you. That is why you're special, because you give all kinds of pendejos a second chance they never asked for. Maybe these friends will graduate. Maybe not. Maybe you'll go to grad nights, but because you're too cool for that, and who are we kidding, too poor. You'll go instead to a bonfire pity party of your remaining friends who are throwing it in someone's Vico Rivera backyard. You'll go because you have no other friends, and even though these guys are working part or full-time jobs at Mervyn's or a forgettable mall rat goth store, you go. You go because you love them, and so what? You have to back them up. If some fool rolled up on you and you were sitting in your homie's tightly packed wagon, and this fool was a white guy, poorer than you, and he tried to say some shit to you like, "Do you even speak English?" you would for sure try to punch him, at least in your mind, and what would come out of your mouth would be, "Yeah, we speak English, I'm better than you." Even if those fuckers don't like you anymore, they'd still defend you and you them. And you did do that. See where it got you. They're all mad at you because you got a diploma, you got a medal for English, because you're going to pack your clothes into a baby blue suitcase that you could fit yourself into if you had to, and they aren't packing shit. At 17, you better hold on to your library books. You better read them all. Read about Chicago and how Mexican girls want to leave their minute houses there, too. Read the book about a black man who changed in prison because of a book he read and became someone who would defend you and your friends in that packed car from that white fool by any means. Read them because these books will not punch you in the face because you're too pretty, cheat on you because you're not white enough, leave you because they're jealous, forget you because they never saw you in the first place. Read them because you don't want to end up like your friends. Read them because there are too many people counting on you. Counting on you too. Thank you.